Now, let me start with picking in on what Simon said in the first session. Simon said that soon we will have camels walking under the Brandenburger Tor in Berlin on the Kurfürstendamm. I can tell you that we have this already in Belgium. Last week, there was a message, and I think Romanians understand French well enough, but there was a message that there was a camel on the rails between Brussels and Arlon in the south of the country. And this was breaking news, a camel on the rail network in Belgium, never seen before. But what happened? There was a bad translation. It was a chat mort that was reported, and they reported it as a chameau. Chat mort, chameau. So everyone was really flabbergasted. Do we really have camels on the railways? But in any case, it shows that sometimes we have difficulties in expressing or explaining or translating certain things. And I think it's the same with this sustainable development agenda. But let me first explain what ECDPM is all about, because this was in fact also one of the questions that you had put to me, the organizers. Explain what ECDPM is all about in two words, or in five words. We are a think and do tank. Think tank, you understand what this means. Do tank means that we are also concerned with making things happen in practice. So we accompany those change actors that have to put all these nice theories and nice analysis into practice. We are non-partisan, and this is very important. I was also asked, why am I interested to work in development? That was, in fact, the last question that I got. I will answer it already. I would say mainly because of this non-partisan character of our foundation, because of the independence that we have, and that's extremely useful. We are not belonging to the European institutions. We are not belonging to the African institutions. We work with both a lot. But we are fully independent, and that gives us a lot of autonomy in the way we think and the way we act. And this is also thanks to a majority of, not majority, but a high number of European member states who provide flexible institutional funding to the foundation. You have the names there, mainly countries of what we could call the old Europe, but they are countries that have, in general, quite important development budgets, and they invest in the foundation in a way that is quite remarkable. There is no strings attached. They are not member of our board, but they provide multi-annual institutional funding just to make sure that we can continue to play that broker role, that non-partisan broker facilitating dialogue mainly between Europe and Africa in a way that is not partisan. This is something which helps to clarify the debates, particularly in domains where there's a lot of controversy between both continents, and that's the role that we love to play. In addition to that, we also have, of course, a number of strategic funding arrangements with a whole range of other actors. Now, just the content, I'm not going to repeat all this, I'm going to rush a bit because many things have already been said, and I'm sure that the other speakers will also repeat elements of what was said earlier and what I'm going to say, so we should maybe allow enough time for discussion. But these are the elements that I would like to cover with a particular emphasis on point three and point four. So if we look at the changes, basically from MDGs to SDGs, I would say it's a more political approach, a more economic and social structural transformation that we are envisaging with the SDGs. And that's, for me, the biggest change. And well, before we were supportive of change processes, mainly in the social sectors in developing countries that were supported by development aid, we are now in a universal type of language in a universal type of approach where we jointly have to tackle global challenges. And this is, for me, the more important element, the political element of the social and economic and ecological transformation agenda. These three elements combined, joint responsibilities, shared responsibilities by all, is indeed what we are aiming for. So the agenda of the SDGs is a fantastic agenda where we can only be happy with. Of course, there's a big problem with the number of SDGs and a big problem also with the targets. I'm coming back to that later. But in essence, the politics behind it are right. They are very interesting, and they are moving us into a new area, which we will also try to reflect in our new strategy at ECDPM and elsewhere. But of course, many will say it's quite utopian, it is not really practical, and that's right. It is a utopian vision, a vision that is definitely not going to be realized in the 15 years to come. So we will have major problems in realizing all this. But let me just mention these elements. I see that my numbers have been going from 1 to 1 to 1 to 1, but basically they should be going from 1 to 4, and there's even more than 4. But basically what we understand as the new shift that is taking place with the MDGs is that we are moving out of this north-south paradigm. And this is hard to digest, because when I talk with African countries and African groups of countries, also the ACP group, African Caribbean Pacific group, African Union and others, they indeed want a different type of relationship that goes beyond aid. But when the guts are down, it's all about the money. The vested interest is such, the addiction to aid is such in a number of circles, that it is very, very difficult to break away with that north-south paradigm. But I think we have to do it. We have to do it, because what we have learned from the north-south type of relationship is that it has created dependence, that it has created, to some extent, clientelism, vested interest, that it has created a way of unilateral transfer of money, which definitely also has not been beneficial for an equal partnership. And we discussed it this morning. Simon brought it up as well. If you really want to have a different type of partnership, you should break away from this system of unilateral transfers of money from one group of countries to other groups of countries. Of course, that's the ideal. And I know that we are not yet there, and we should be very realistic. And one of the realities is that we have, at this moment, a number of countries, happily decreasing, but still significant number of countries, that will need aid, that will need international cooperation, fragile states, countries that are really affected by major problems of development. And there, of course, aid will be necessary. But for all these other countries, we need to find other ways of dealing with these. If I just give you the example of a country like Angola, potentially very, very rich. Only 5, maybe 8 years ago, the European Commission was putting 8 conditionalities to a country like Angola, believing that they could make the political system change by giving a bit more or a bit less development cooperation. That's, of course, ridiculous. There's not one of these leaders in those countries, rich countries, which, by the way, are buying half of Portugal at this moment, that is going to will to be willing to change their policies because of aid. So 8 conditionalities did not work. So we should be more sophisticated in using aid to bring about structural change processes, to support these structural change processes, local actors who can drive change, rather than believing that we can bring change from within the European Union to these countries. So this is a very important thing. Moving beyond north-south paradigm is going to be a big, big challenge. Moving towards policy coherence for sustainable development. I'm not going to go into the details. We work a lot on this in ECDPM, in many European member states, also with OECD. And this is going to be discussed tomorrow. But what is important in the SDG agenda is that we will move to the breaking of silos. We will combine different components that have an impact on development. We will look at different policies that impact on development. We will look at economy, at equity, at ecology. These are the elements that need to be combined, and this is for me also a very important move forward with the SDGs. New sources of financing. New sources of financing are needed, and I just wanted to mention this report, the European Report on Development, which was done, amongst others, with ODI, DIE, combining finance and policies to implement a transformative post-2015 development agenda. If you look at what is mentioned there, it's already very spectacular what has been achieved in the past 10 years. Domestic public revenues in the past 10 years, tax and non-tax revenues rose by 272%. So it means that many developing countries have been able to start raising more taxes, more domestic revenue. International public finance, aid, ODA, only rose by 114%. But then private domestic finance rose by 415%. And private international finance rose by 297% in the past 10 years. These are very spectacular figures, and they put ODA, aid, into perspective. ODA at this moment stands for 1.5% of total resources available. But of course, this doesn't mean that ODA is not needed. It means that we need to target it better, and that a number of countries will never be able at this stage, because they are too fragile, to attract that domestic and international private investment. Private investment is moving to middle-income countries. It's not moving to fragile states with conflict. So aid will still have a role to play, but we will have to differentiate much more our aid to certain groups of people and certain groups of countries. And this makes it also important. Last point, the new global governance, it's an element that is not explicitly mentioned all the time in the SDG agenda, but for us it's an important element, because everywhere we come across in Africa, in the institutions, we hear that Europe is losing some credibility, and then you hear the European ambassador, for example, in Addis Ababa, saying, yes, but we are the largest contributor in terms of aid. At the end of the day, what Africa wants and what many developing regions want is to have a more legitimate place in the global system. They want to have their seat in, for example, the Security Council. They want to have a seat in the IMF, World Bank, Bretton Woods institutions. And that's going to be the big, big challenge. Are we willing to give up power? When I put that question in meetings where UK and France are present, none of them will ever admit that this is an issue, but it is an issue. At a certain moment, Europe will have to stand firm together as European Union to make sure that we can defend one seat as European Union, rather than having France and Britain sitting, for example, in the Security Council, in a world where there's so many changes happening, where so many new powers are rising. We need to be more modest there, and we need to admit that alone, in about one generation, there will not be one European member state in the top 20 of strongest world economies. That is the reality. So as European Union, we will have to stand firm and make sure that we can play our role. Risk analysis with the MDGs, with the SDGs, it is of course a bit pick and choose. All things to all people, overly ambitious of course, as I said. Will we resolve all global problems in the next 15 years? Because that's a bit what we have put forward as ambition. Quite unrealistic, but I take the point of Simon and others that we are moving. We are making progress, we have made a lot of progress, but this is of course impossible to realize that progress in only 15 years. The vision is overly ambitious. But of course you need to start somewhere with an ambitious vision, but then you have to put the question, who finally does what? And what I see all the time when I participate in these and other types of meetings is that the southern and the so-called northern partners, insofar that we can still talk about north and south, are watching each other and are saying, you have to act, we don't have to act. So everyone is putting the blame on each other and no one is really starting to move. And moving means a lot. In my own country, for example, we have a big, big discussion about company cars. Everyone in Belgium who works in a private company gets a free car. That's a kind of way of evading taxes, the high tax rates in Belgium. They offer you a fringe benefit, which is a car. So we have something like 600,000, 700,000 cars on our roads that pollute, that make Brussels the most impossible city in Europe in terms of traffic, much worse than Paris or London. So something needs to be done about this. But politicians who are at this moment pushing these type of measures, they don't make a chance to abolish this. It is impossible at this moment to shift the mentalities away from the private company car, which people see as a kind of a right. But we will have to act accordingly. Another issue, how to measure, it has been said several times, you don't easily measure some of the SDGs, particularly the more political ones. And that's also where we have most controversies, the so-called SDG 16, which calls for peaceful and more democratic societies. Many developing countries did not want to include this in the text. I think it's an essential component. You need to include the politics, because development essentially is about politics. It's not technocratic, it's politics. So many, many risks that are involved in this agenda, and there is a fear that this would be perceived by some as a kind of business as usual, so we will have to act accordingly. And then the European Union, of course, has a role to play. European Union is always quite well advanced in putting forward nice policies. They are less good in implementing these policies. So they will have to also integrate this in the policies of individual countries, and there will be a lot of complexities that need to be tackled. Europe will have to deal with a very differentiated type of approach. How will we work beyond aid with countries that have graduated out of aid? What can we offer these countries? We can offer them maybe trade deals, yes, but what else can we offer them? Maybe a place in global governance. But we need to be much more creative. We need to be sometimes also much more risk-taking in finding ways to reach out not only to the least developed countries where we have a number of instruments, but also to these middle-income countries and to these large populations in middle-income countries that are suffering more and more from bigger inequalities. Inequalities, by the way, that also increase day after day in our European Union member states. Also, we in Europe will have to halve inequality by 2030, while we see that the trend is very much going into the opposite direction. There is more poverty now in Europe than it used to be, and I'm not talking only about Greece, but it's happening in most countries. Inequality is growing, while we are saying that by 2030 we will halve inequality globally, worldwide. Political action, I just mentioned this, but I think it's important regarding the global governance. What will we do about it? So in conclusion, I think it's an opportunity to move to a new type of multilateralism, and that attracts us very much. We think that this is a different way of looking at global problems, global issues. We are definitely much more aware about the politics to tackle structural problems of inequality. Only 20, 30 years ago, we were still believing that we would tackle underdevelopment with a bit of technical assistance and a bit of training. Now we know much better. We know that the politics need to be right. And then the question is, what do you do to make sure that the politics are right? We know that conditionalities don't work. So we need to be more creative in reaching out to the change actors in the developing countries themselves, who finally have to bring about change. We have to be more looking into sophisticated ways, therefore, of development cooperation. And then, of course, we need to be very clear in how we can measure this agenda. Let me just conclude by saying that there is definitely an important role to be played by all of you, because I guess that most of you are civil society organizations. Not necessarily to always push the agenda of the developing countries, but to make sure that you can start working from here. Start working also in your own country to bring about change and to make sure that this agenda will really an agenda that will be carried out, be it probably not in the next 15 years, but definitely in the next generations. Thank you very much.